Dear participants, patron of this online national webinar, Dr. Sister Jyoti, Principal Nirmala College, Ranchi, and our esteemed resource person, Professor Anila Kaviraj, Department of Zoology, Kalyani University, Kalyani, have joined us. With the permission of the patron, I start the day's event. Respected Principal, Nirmala College. Respected Principal, Nirmala College, Dr. Sister Jyoti, Vice Principal, Sister Shobha, Honorable Resource Person, Professor Anila Kaviraj, Co-Convener of the webinar, Dr. Anubhuti Singh, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, Nirmala College, members of organizing team, and dear participants, a warm good morning to you all. On behalf of departments of Botany and Zoology, with immense joy and love, I welcome our dignitaries and participants in the two-day online national webinar on the topic Pandemic COVID-19, Pathophysiology, Prevention and Treatment. For some time, I will wait so that our patron, if she has some connectivity problem, can join us. So please wait for a few seconds. Good morning, sister. Are you comfortable now?
Good morning, yeah.
Yes, sister. So may I proceed now, sister?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, sister.
Actually, my laptop is not working, not connecting. That is why I was shifting from this mobile to laptop. So am I audible, Emma?
Yes, sister. Yes, sister.
Am I audible? Clear.
Yes, sister. You are very clear.
Okay. Yes. So wish you all a very warm and blessed good morning.
Yes, sister. Now, may I proceed? I have to speak a little more about you,
okay,
please.
Okay.
Thank you, sister. Thank you.
Okay.
So with immense pride and exaltation, I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate our patron, Dr. Sister Jyoti, Principal Nirmala College, for achieving Corona Karamveer Samman under Rashtra Srijan Abhiyan. Our patron is continuously working for the underprivileged people of the society during this pandemic period. She is taking care of academics too. She is constantly organizing a skill development program and workshops for the students, faculty enrichment programs for the faculty. She is also helping us to organize webinars. She is the guiding light of institution. Hearty congratulations to Sister Principal.
Thank you.
I humbly request our motivating and guiding light, Dr. Sister Jyoti, to address this online August gathering and bless us for the fruitful sessions. Over to Sister Principal.
Thank you, Dr. Emma Rani. Wish you all a very warm and blessed good morning. Johar, our esteemed guest and resource person of the day, Professor Anivala, Kalyani University, West Bengal, organizers Dr. Emma Rani Seraphim and Dr. Anubhuti Singh and their entire team, faculty members, distinguished guests, dear students and all participants from far and wide. I feel highly privileged and proud to witness the two-day national webinar jointly organized by Departments of Zoology and Botany, Nirmala College, Ranchi, affiliated to Ranchi University, Ranchi, a college with potential for excellence, accredited by NAC with grade A, under the dynamic leadership of Dr. Emma Rani Seraphim and Dr. Anubhuti and their entire team on the topic pandemic, COVID-19, pathophysiology, prevention and treatment. Relevant topic indeed. We all are well aware of the fact that the pandemic COVID-19 has changed the world on a larger scale. It has not just changed our lifestyle, but even our mindsets. The news is filled with stories of sickness, deaths, misery, and disappointments. Although the repercussion of health individual is devastating, yet we need to have faith and confidence on the knowledge economy of our country that would surely generate a roadmap of safety. But as we all know, stopping to act is not the solution. We need to think, to understand, to analyze, to create and recreate the option of development. Nonetheless, education is the best tool that can help us survive our economy, our nation. COVID-19 is a dreadful outcome of the selfish interest of mankind, I believe. But the solution too lies in our efforts. It's quite obvious that there is no storage of frustrating information when it comes to COVID-19. Exposure to all this negativity makes even the most optimistic among us feel depressed. We need to understand the role of the microorganism and extent of its control. The best way is to spread awareness and educate the masses. Nirmala College just tries to continue to educate everyone to fight with this disease with confidence, alertness, and above all, the mantra of fitness through organizing such webinars. Hopefully, this platform plays a pivotal role in enlightening ourselves for fighting and managing the virus. I congratulate Department of Zoology and Botany for their efforts to organize this webinar that would substantiate more of learning, more of understanding, and more of maintaining the physiological states of our mind and body. My blessings and best wishes for the day. I pray and seek the blessings of the Almighty for the fruitful deliberations and uninterrupted support of Network 2. May you have a pleasant time. May God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sister. Thank you for your blessings and prayers. So we will go ahead. COVID-19 pandemic caused by SARS-CoV-2 has been the global health crisis of our time. It is the greatest challenge we have ever faced. The first case of COVID-19 in India was reported on 30th January 2020. Currently, India has the largest number of confirmed cases in the world after United States and Brazil. SARS-CoV-2 has the potential to create devastating health crisis, social crisis, economic and political effects that will be deep and long-lasting scars left on us. So we need to prepare ourselves by knowing more and more about the source, transmission, and pathogenicity of coronavirus. For this, in session one, we have with us Honorable Resource Person, Professor Emeritus Anilav Kaviraj, Department of Zoology, Kalyani University, Kalyani, West Bengal. I request Dr. Anjali Smitha, Assistant Professor, Zoology Department, Nirmala College, Ranchi, to introduce our esteemed resource person. Over to Anjali.
Thank you, Dr. Emma. Good morning, everybody. We are pleased to have with us honorable spokesperson, Professor Anilav Kaviraj, sir, has been a professor of zoology at University of Kalyani. He served the department for 33 years together with service at University of Kalyani as member Faculty Council for Science. He has expertise in the field of aquatic toxicology and has popularized application of atomic absorption spectrophotometer. He has substantial research on mathematical modeling to evaluate bioaccumulation as well as bioremediation of metals in aquatic organisms in collaboration with faculties from Aalborg University, Denmark. Sir, you have more than 110 research papers in high impact factor international peer reviewed journals. He has supervised 23 PhDs.
Hello. Yes, ma'am.
Visited countries like USA, Italy, France, Spain, Czech Republic. Currently, he is a member of Studies in Zoology of Calcutta University, member of PG Studies in Life Science, Assam University, member Board of Research Studies at Vishwabharati University and Tripura University, and an expert member of Animal Ethics Committee and Department of Zoology. So, on behalf of the Nirmala Fraternity, I welcome you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam, for your kind introduction. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Okay. So, good morning, Principal Ma'am. And
good morning, sir.
Good morning to Dr. Emma Rani Serafim and Dr. Anubhuti Singh, head of the departments of Zoology and Botany. Good morning to my colleagues over there and also my zoologist friends in Rachi. And also my best wishes to the distinguished speaker in this, other distinguished speaker in this webinar. So let me first share the screen. So host has disabled the participant sharing screen. Kindly enable it. Okay. So I am starting the source transmission and pathogenicity of the coronaviruses. Now we are in the 9 months of this pandemic, as it started from December 2019 in Wuhan city in China. And in India, we are in the fifth month, if we take into account the, when the lockdown started in India. And like millions of people in this country, I am also one of those. The question arises to me, how long will it stay? And right at this moment, frankly speaking, there is no clear-cut answer to these questions. But there is a website in coronavirus.org based in England. They show that there are some countries which have already controlled this pandemic. And these countries are included in the green countries, and they are right at this moment, there are about 40 to 45 countries who have controlled this pandemic within 4 weeks to 12 weeks. But the total cases in these countries were in only thousands. And there are other group of countries which fall into yellow countries, in which they have almost controlled this pandemic. Right now they have reached the plateau, and there is a slight fluctuation in the infection, daily infection rate, and they have reached the plateau within 10 weeks to 16 weeks. Now, unfortunately, in India, we belong to the red countries zone, in which there is, even after 5 months, the infection rate is still rising. So we do not know when it will reach to plateau. Interestingly, one of our neighbor, Pakistan, has recently entered into the yellow zone country, because in the last 1 month, the Pakistan has showed a steady decline in the daily infection rate. Only yesterday, the infection rate in Pakistan was only 600 plus, while in India it was 62,000 plus. What is the reason behind this? There may be a genetic difference between the populations. There may be some ecobiological determining factors which influence the COVID-19 infections. But you see, we belong to the same geographic region. We have similarities in and the characteristics of the demography. Still, India is not showing similarity with the Pakistan. Rather, we are showing similarities with the USA, Brazil, South Africa, Russia. So what is the reason behind this? Some molecular biologists say that they are emphasizing that we need to know the mutations of these viruses, the genetic mutations, the recent genotypes of the viruses. It may be that there are some genotypes which are more virulent, there are some genotypes which are less virulent. We are not in a position right now to answer all these questions, but let me try to find some clues at the end of my lecture. Now, let me start with the structure of this virus. And by this time, the structure has been known to many people, particularly those belonging to the biology discipline. But this is not the structure of the recent COVID-19 virus or SARS-CoV-2 virus. This is a generalized structure of the all coronaviruses, in which it is an enveloped virus. That means it has an envelope, it is enveloped by a biolipid layer and a protein. And there are four structural proteins in the name of E protein, envelope protein, M protein, membrane protein, and nucleocapsid protein, which remain associated with the RNAs. And most important is the spike protein, which is the instrument for the virus to attach itself to the host cell. Along with this, there are many non-structural protein within the cell of this virus, which are instrumental in the replication of the virus as well as controlling the immunity of the host cell. So with this structure will be helpful to relate some of the parts of my lecture. Now, history of this infection. I am not talking about the history of the evolution of the virus, because right at this moment it is not known when this virus evolved. It may be in between 30,000 to 30 millions of years. But so far as the infection in man, it was first reported by Tyrrell and Bion in 1965. These authors, they observed that this virus looked like corona of sun, and from then this virus was named as coronavirus. But finally, only in 2002, we came to know that this virus can severely infect human beings, because in China, it appeared as an outbreak of SARS-CoV-2002. That means severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2002. Thereafter, in 2012, again another virus, coronavirus, emerged in Middle East. It was known as Middle East Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus, or in short, MERS-CoV-2012. Now we are having this SARS-CoV-2 from December 2019. So only within the first two decades of this century, we have three outbreaks of the coronavirus. Now, this is in precise the classification of the coronavirus. There are several coronaviruses, but I like to highlight only the blue colored viruses. Apart from this recent COVID-19, that means SARS-CoV-2, we have six other viruses which can infect the human being. That's why these are called human coronavirus, or in short, HCoV. And these are indicated by some numbers, as for example, HCoV-229E, NL63, etc., etc. And four earlier human coronaviruses are named like this, HCoV. And the recent three coronaviruses, which started from 2002, these are named by the symptoms they produce in the human being, as for example, SARS-CoV 2002, severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus, or MERS-CoV. And recently we are having SARS-CoV-2, and according to the corona study group of the International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses, this is most closely to the SARS-CoV 2002, and this was named as SARS-CoV-2 or the SARS-CoV 2019 or COVID-19. Now, from this picture, you see that this entire coronavirus group is divided into four categories: alpha coronavirus, beta coronavirus, and gamma coronavirus, and delta coronavirus. Two human coronaviruses, HCoV-229E, NL63, they belong to alpha coronaviruses, and all other five categories, they belong to the beta coronaviruses, although into different lineages as per the classification of these viruses concept. Now, with this concept in mind, let me say that these viruses are zoonotics. That means they have an origin in non-human animal, and from non-human animal, they jump to human beings. And among the different groups of mammalian hosts, we find that the bats and rodents are the most important principal reservoirs. They are not the only reservoir, because these viruses, zoonotic viruses, are found in many other orders of mammalia, but the bats and rodents are the principal, and they harbor the maximum number of the zoonotic viruses. So far as the comparison between bats and rodents are concerned, the bats contain 137 number of total viruses, rodents contain 170 number of viruses. Some publications say that the number may be more than that. And so far as the zoonotic viruses are there, it may be 61 for bats, 68 for rodents, but so far as the average number of viruses per species, bats hold the higher number than that of the rodents. But in the bottom side figure, you can see so far the genomic sequence is concerned, the bat contains more than 10,000 number of genomic sequences. And so far as the coronavirus family are concerned, they contain more than 3,796 genomic sequences. So how important is the bat so far as the animal reservoir of the bat is concerned? Now, from this slide, we know that the earlier four coronaviruses, earlier four coronaviruses, now it is still, these are present in human beings, but are not producing so much of the problems to the human beings, except for mild fever and other influenza symptoms. Now, so far as these four coronaviruses are concerned, for two of them, the bat was the natural host, and for two of them, the rodents were the natural host. Hello? Now, for one of the virus, the camel was the intermediate host, and for another virus, the cow was the intermediate host. That means from eating the beef, this disease was transferred or transmitted to the human being. So it is assumed that from either bat or from the rodents, the disease was transmitted to the man through some intermediate host. For two of these earlier coronaviruses, we know the intermediate host. For two of the viruses, we do not know the intermediate host. Now let us come to the recent SARS-like coronaviruses, which started in 2002. Now we are facing the endemic of the SARS-CoV-2 from 2019. And it has been found that diverse SARS-like coronaviruses have been reported from bats in China, Europe, and Africa. And principally, the horseshoe bats of China have been found as the natural reservoirs of the SARS-like coves. Now, so far as the distribution of the coves throughout the world is concerned, this coronavirus distribution is associated with the distribution of the bats, particularly the horseshoe bats. And as, for example, I have told you that these human coviruses fall into two different categories. One, two belong to alpha coronaviruses and five other belong to the beta coronaviruses. And the alpha coronaviruses, they are distributed to maximum countries of the world. Particularly in the North America, they are distributed almost all over North America, and still now they are causing some influenza problem in the North America. So far as the beta coronaviruses are concerned, that means this HCoV-OC43-HKU1 and the recent three corona SARS-like coronaviruses, they are not so much widely distributed. Particularly earlier, this coronavirus and the bats were not distributed throughout the world, particularly in the America, Australasia, because the population of horseshoe bats are less in America and Australasia. Now, after the infection started to man and from man to man infection, now it has become pandemic to all over the world from different, it has spread to different continents. Now, there are some places where both alpha and beta coronaviruses are found. Now, the question definitely arises, why did it originate in China? In fact, in China, there is a province, Yunnan, which is the ideal ecological niche for the different species of horseshoe bats. And in fact, these areas, not only in Yunnan, but also in the southwest part of the China, they show the highest animal diversity. And these are the geographical regions where also we find highest diversity of the SARS-like coronaviruses. So there is a possibility that the maximum number of coronaviruses and their host are available in this part of the world. So how did coronaviruses jump from the bat to the human being? This is the question of the day. How did transmission took place? Now, three possible ways. Number one is a bat-to-bat interaction. Number two is a bat-to-animal interaction. And number three is bat-to-man interaction. Now, bat-to-bat interaction is possible, and several papers are there, recent papers and the old papers, that the cross-species transmission is possible, particularly in the population of bats where they are sympatric. Sympatric, for the non-biologist audience, those species which different species when remain together in a particular geographic region, they are called sympatric. And in sympatric population, it is very easy to transmit from one individual or one species to another species. While there are some other papers recently in some certain parts of the West Indian islands like Mozambique, Mauritius, Madagascar, etc., where the bats are distributed in different islands, that is, they are allopatric, so far as the ecology is concerned, there the evidence for sharing of the virus is limited. So far the bat to other species, other animal is concerned, interaction between bat and other animals, the bats have several predators in the form of owls, hawks, weasels, and raccoon dogs. Currently, there is a report that the raccoon dogs are infected by the coronaviruses. It has been, SARS-like cause has been detected in the raccoon dog in the Chinese wet market. Now, let us come to the bat-man interaction. How it is possible? It is possible when the bat is taken as a food, when the food is contaminated by bat, when the man hunt the bat, that means the bat hunters has the possibility to be associated with the virus from the bats. Now, in the left side bottom picture is a picture. Recently, I have got it from one of the website. So, this is a very common picture in Chinese wet market, Huanan market. So, this is not a new one because the Chinese, they prefer the live bats. And this is not their new habit. This is a old habit. But the virus has recently caused the pandemic. And so far as the non-coronavirus is concerned, there are many reports that the food can be contaminated by the bats, like that the fruit-eating bats, they can easily contaminate the date palm sap. And in Bangladesh, the Nipah virus contamination is very frequently reported. And the bat hunter, there are many reports of the virus infection from the bats to the man in Cameroon, Henipa virus, Rio virus in Malaysia, Filo virus in India. But these are non-coronaviruses. But non-coronavirus can also become dangerous in near future. And there may be that the bats can all, the coronavirus can also transmit from the bat to man directly. Now, how did this virus jump in this situation? How did this virus jump from bat to the other species? It is assumed that it is probably a case of spillover. How? The spillover probably was caused by host viral shedding. What is the host viral shedding? That means the virus not only affect the respiratory system as we are now facing for the human beings throughout the world, it can cause many other tissues. It can, from the respiratory system, it can go to the intestine, it can go to the kidney, it can go to the heart. So when they are in the intestine or the digestive system, the virus can be shedded through the excreta. It can be shedded through the urine when they are found in the kidney. So once this virus come out through the excreta or the urine into the environment, so there is a question that will this virus survive in the environment? So it depends upon the environmental situation, the temperature, humidity, and other factors, how long the virus will stay or survive in the environment. Another important question is that the presence of susceptible recipient intermediate host. If there is any other animal in the vicinity of the virus shedding, it can catch. But it also depends upon the virus host molecular and cellular compatibility. The virus can infect the other animal only when the virus spike protein can attach to the cell membrane of the host. That means there must be some compatibility between the spike protein and the receptor molecule of the cell membrane of the host cell. So this is some of the primary conditions for the spillover and the infection of the intermediate host. And yes, so far as the ecology is concerned, the spillover of the virus is related with many biological phenomena of the virus. That means particularly the reproduction cycle of the virus, the diurnal cycle of the reproduction cycle of the bat, and the diurnal cycle of the bat. Now, mask palm civet, or in scientific name is Paguma larvata. So far as the IUCN status is concerned for non-biologist audience, so International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, they classify the animal into different categories according to the danger they are facing. Some of the animals are considered as threatened. Some of the animals are considered as least threatened or not endangered. So threatened animals fall into the category of the critically endangered, endangered, and vulnerable. So this animal is least concerned. That means this, there is no danger for this animal. But this animal is favored in China as a very food, and for this, these animals are farmed. They are cultured in farms. And it has been found that the viral infection from the bat, which is the is found more in the farm civet rather than in the wild civet. Why? Because in the farms, there are tall trees, which are also the habitat of the birds. And from where the shedding of the virus easily can reach to the bottoms of the farms in the form of excreta and the urine, and the animals can easily be contaminated by the virus shedded by the bats, which is not possible, or there is a remote possibility of such contamination in the wild. So the man has a role for bringing this intermediate host, possible intermediate host, in the vicinity of the virus and facilitate the viral spillover event, bringing susceptible recipient host to the vicinity of the viral source. Now, coming to the summary of this event, the source of animal, primary reservoir or secondary reservoir. Now, so far as this COVID-19 is concerned, it is assumed that it is not possible for the virus to transmit directly from the bat to the man because there is not the spike protein and the receptor binding molecules of the host cell of the man is not compatible. So that's why it is a remote possibility the virus was transmitted directly from the bat to the man. Now, then there is a question that it was transferred to some intermediate animal where there was some mutation, and due to this mutation, the compatibility developed between the spike protein and the receptor binding molecules of the human cell. And there was a seroprevalence study in Hong Kong and retro seroprevalence study in which it was found that some people developed this antibody against this SARS-like coronavirus even before it appeared in 2002. By this way, it is assumed that the people were exposed to the virus even before the outbreak started in 2002. However, so far as the non-coronavirus infection is concerned, as I immediately mentioned, that the virus, the non-coronavirus, can directly transfer to the from bat to the man. And recently, there is a, not recently, in 2013, there was a paper in the Nature in which particularly one virus, SARS-like CoV-W1V1, it can grow in human alveolar vessel epithelial cell. This was a cell cycle, cell culture study, not the direct study. So by this way, some authors can say that the virus can directly jump to the human being from the bat without necessity of an intermediate host. But rightly, the molecular biologists say that there is a less compatibility between the spike protein of the coronaviruses and the receptor binding molecules of the human being. Now, so far as the MERS-CoV is concerned, the intermediate host was found as a dromedary camel and the primary host was Egyptian tombat. And so far as the SARS-CoV was concerned, there was about 8,000 infection and the mortality rate was about 11%. And so far as the MERS-CoV is concerned, it was only 2,000 and the mortality rate was about 30%. Fortunately, the MERS-CoV was very dangerous, but fortunately, man-to-man transmission rate was very, very less. It was less contagious. And so far as the other animal infection is concerned, not many studies have been done. There was a study in Ghana. It was found that it was unlikely to be transmitted to cattle, sheep, and goat, donkeys, swine, etc. MERS-CoV. Now, there is an interesting study, very intriguing report from one group of scientists, very recent paper, that they say that this SARS-CoV COVID-19, for COVID-19, the snake can be also the intermediate host. And the basis of this claim is that the hot snake soup is a favored dish in China also. So this is the reason behind this assumption, but not only this assumption, but they have made some analysis to say that the snake can also be an intermediate host. But this is not supported by many scientists, because for the non-biologist audience, you know that the snake belong to the cold-blooded animals, and it is most unlikely that the virus can jump from a cold-blooded animal to the hot-blooded animal like the bat or to the other mammals or the human being. And why the scientists are not supporting this, not giving much weightage to this theory, because the basis of this claim was the codon usage pattern. This is a technique by which the scientists study whether an animal can be an intermediate host. This is the codon usage pattern, means there are 20 amino acids which are encoded by 61 codons of a genome, and plus C stop codons are there during the transcription of the amino acids, during the translation process, Now these are, and so that means for 20 amino acid, the one amino acid can be coded by more than one codon. And these alternative codons can be up to 6 codons. And these codons are called the synonymous codons. And this, every animal, they have a preference for some synonymous codon. This is known as the codon bias or codon usage bias. Virus tend to evolve codon usage bias that is comparable to their host. Now, what is the deficiency of this technique? Deficiency of this technique that some group have found that comparing codon usage bias, usage of the three coronaviruses, SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV, it has been for 10,000 different animals. It was found that the codon usage of the coronavirus is not determined by its host. Rather, the codon usage of SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV is much closer to frogs and snakes rather than to its real animal host like the civets or the camels. So there is a deficiency in this technique, and the claim that the snakes can be an intermediate host is not gaining weightage. So let us come to the COVID-19, which is our concern now. Now, the people started the searching the animal host, particularly if the bat is the primary host, then there was a search for intermediate host. And since there is a lockdown, since there is a low movement, there is no transport, so only source of this analysis or for this research is a website that shares the all genome of these viruses called Global Initiative on Sharing All Influenza Data, in short GISAID. They supply the genome of the different coronaviruses all over the world, and recent bat coronavirus named as BatCoV RATG13, which is found in Rhinophilus affinis, a horseshoe bat, and which show maximum similarity with the SARS-CoV-2 from the human being. So, with this website, and this scientist started searching the intermediate host of the coronavirus or SARS-CoV-2. So there was this was the top suspect, Malayan or Sunda pangolin, Manis javanica. As per IUCN, this is critically endangered. That means it cannot be sold in the market. It cannot be transported from one country to another country. But the feed, the meat and the scale of this animal is favored in China and many other Southeast Asian countries. So these are smuggled. Since this is critically endangered animal, they cannot be marketed, they cannot be transported, these are smuggled. And recently, the SARS-like coronavirus has been found from their body, which genetically is very much close to the SARS-CoV-2 from the human being. But there is a question, do really pangolins stand in between the bat and man? So far the genetic match is concerned, some other panelists will discuss in detail, but I can say right now that so far as the genetic match with the spike protein, which is called receptor binding protein domain, they show 99% match, which is a very good match. But so far as the entire genome is concerned, they show only 90.3% match. So this is not a good, so far as the matching, genetic matching between different animal is concerned. So this is a very recent study, and many scientists believe that this matching. Now, coming to summary of this, that means that from horseshoe bat, the bat was transmitted to man through which? Because direct transfer was not possible because receptor binding domain of the coronavirus from Rhinophilus affinis is different from that of the SARS-CoV-2 from man. So far as the pangolin is concerned, they have a receptor binding protein of 99%. Match, but overall match is the 90%. So the question still remains whether the pangolin is the really the intermediate host for the SARS-CoV-2. Now there are other questions, because this only Sunda pangolin is considered right now, but there are many other pangolins all over the world. All are threatened. some belong to critically endangered, some belong to endangered category, some are vulnerable, and all are now the marketing, transport, shipment of this animal from their own habitat is banned by all countries, and from internationally it is also banned. So this is a, it is, and now the scientists ask the question, the Malay pangolin is distributed in Brunei, Cambodia, Indonesia, Malaysia and Thailand. Why there have not been reports of people being infected in these countries before being spread through man to man? It was first reported from China. Why not in these countries? The farms of civet cats provided a favorable environment for bat to shed viruses. So far as the SARS-CoV-2 was concerned, no such situation exists for pangolin. Similarly, the horseshoe bats, Rhinolophus affinis, is distributed in Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, India, Indonesia, Malaysia, Nepal, Thailand, and Vietnam. Were these two animals under any selection pressure to switch over their host? Or was it due to simply food habit of Chinese? The food habit is not a recent one. They are having this food habit for a long, long time. Why it has appeared in 2002, 2012, and 2019 again? Now, there is a question to ask, will this virus jump from man to another animal, or it will remain in subdued condition in the man, human body? So if pangolins are the intermediate host, why don't we consider the other animal potential intermediate host? In fact, the raccoon dogs, cats, ferret badger, they have been found to carry their SARS-like coronaviruses. And the primary condition that an animal can become the intermediate host is the compatibility between receptor binding domain and the receptor molecule, which is known as the AC2 molecule in the host cell. Man and some of these animals, that means raccoon dogs, cats, ferret, badger, they have AC2 receptor homology. So that's why these animals can be potential intermediate host. So, but we still do not know whether humans can get infected by the coronavirus residing with these animals. In recent studies show that the pigs and chickens are not susceptible to SARS coronaviruses, but we are not sure about, because we know there are other viruses which are called animal coronaviruses, not the human coronaviruses, like avian infection, bronchitis virus in poultry, TGEV in pigs, PEDV in pigs, SARS-CoV in pigs. So it is not known whether they will be again dangerous and infect the man. They remain in the animal right now, but it is not known like that of the SARS-CoV-2, it will come to man and be dangerous in near future. So some unresolved question again, neither the bat coronavirus nor the pangolin beta coronavirus sampled so far thus far have polyvasic cleavage site. This is a new acquisition, because with the spike protein that I have shown you earlier, they have two components, S1 and S2. And in between S1 and S2, there is a cleavage site called furin cleavage site, and which is a new acquisition of this virus. Now, so far as this new acquisition is concerned, it has been found, it has not been found in SARS-CoV related coronavirus, which appeared in 2002, but this is present in human coronavirus OC43, HKU1 and MERS-CoV. How did this polyvasic cleavage site arise in SARS-CoV-2? Was it an evolutionary, natural evolutionary process? Or there was some recombination of segments between the two viruses? So this picture show you the polyvasic motif in between S1 and S2. This was the paper from Molecular Cell, appeared in 2020. Now, another important question, reverse transmission. Now we know that this virus has spread from man to man throughout the world. Can it be transmitted from man to animal? We don't have any published paper, but there are some reports from print media and electronic media that the cat in Belgium, tiger in New York, mink in Netherlands, they can be infected from the man. So these animals have shown symptoms of coronaviruses, as we find in case of the man. Dogs are also suspected. There is a nice website who take care of the animal health, and we find different recent reports on the infection of the animals on from these viruses. Now, summarizing this transmission of the viruses from the bat to the human being, do the bat and the coronaviruses probably co-evolved together, and that is the history of 30 to 50 million years that the scientists are assuming. Now, why these viruses have suddenly switched over from the bat to the human being and has become so much virulent? Are these the events of some ecological alteration? This is a burning question of the day to the zoologist and ecologist and to the biologist in general. Was there encroachment of the virgin areas? Was there any global climate change? Recently we have seen many forest fires throughout the world. And there are some ecological questions, as I also mentioned in earlier, that the sympatric species, they are more susceptible to the viral infection. And there are other features like R-selected animals. So ecology students will know what are R-selected animals. Again, for the non-biologist audience, I like to say that the animals which produce huge number of offsprings, which produce a frequent number of offspring, they belong to the R-selected animals. And it has been found they are infected by the virus more than the other such species of the bats. Now, we have already known that the receptor binding protein of SARS-CoV-2 is optimized for binding to human molecular receptor AC2. How did it happen? The two scenarios that can be possibly explain this new feature. Now, mode of infection. I shall not tell in details about this topic because there are some doctors in this panel, but simply in a brief note, I like to say that the spike protein binds to the receptor angiotensin converting enzyme or AC2 enzyme and to enter into the host cell. In the second part of this entry, the cleavage site between S1 and S2 is broken by furin and serine protease TMPRSS2 for final entry into the host cell. I am not competent enough to explain in detail about the molecular biology of this entry. There are other panelists who will describe it in detail, but I just want to say that this is a new acquisition in this virus. And after this entry, the virus starts synthesis of the non-structural protein and the structural proteins, and the replication of the virus starts. Now, so far the infection starts, and I have already mentioned that there are 7 coronaviruses that infect man, and the green-colored coronaviruses, they still exist in man. Once they were very much virulent, now today these are in subdued condition. They cause only mild influenza, and they used to infect only the upper respiratory part. And so far the SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV, they were dangerous because they traveled to the lower respiratory part and affected the lungs. That's why they were called the severe acute respiratory syndrome viruses. And the SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID-19, they acquired the both properties. That means they infected the upper part of the respiratory system because the man faced the loss of taste, loss of smell. They also affect the lungs. That means the main respiratory part of the human being. It is not that they affect only the lungs, but in the lungs, the pneumocyte cells, they have better expression of the AC2 receptor. But from the lung, it can go to the intestine, kidney, heart, and many other properties. Those who are stable in these respiratory system infection, they can suffer other symptoms. The doctors will say you better about this infection. Now, why SARS-CoV-2 has become so virulent? It affects both upper respiratory part as well as the lower respiratory parts. It is possible. It is not sure. We cannot say surely right now. It is possible that there was a recombination between any of the benign COVs and the virulent two SARS-like COVs in some intermediate host. For the non-biologist audience, again, it is like that the binding of the head of one animal to the body of the other animal. For higher animal, it is not possible except in mythological stories. But there is a strong evidence in recent paper, 2017, it has been suggested that a recombination event occurred between human COVID-229E-like virus from the bat, C. deras bats, and HCoV NL63-like virus found in another bat. So there is evidence that recombination can take place in some intermediate animals or in bats also. So to develop such a virulent strain of the virus. So coming almost to the last part of this, my lecture, there is a spontaneous mutation. All RNA virus show spontaneous mutation of the virus. It's fortunate, but all mutations are not active. Some are silent. They do not change to the encoded proteins. Others change in the amino acid, but functionally they are not so much active. But there are some mutations which changes the immunogenicity of the viral protein, which can impact virulence and transmissibility of the virus to the man. So depending upon these features, the recent virus, COVID-19, has become a virulent one. It is assumed that the SARS-CoV-2 has mutated into several genotypes throughout the world. But I initially told that the molecular biologists are emphasizing that it is necessary to start a study the different genotypes that the virus has developed into, so that we can assess which genotype is more virulent, which genotype is less virulent. So far, I understand that there are about 30 genotypes of this virus recently. So this is the question. How long we have to wait? We have to end with some happy note, with some positive indication. A less contagious virus is more fatal, as SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV, they were less contagious but more fatal. SARS-CoV-2 is more contagious. Right now, almost 2 crores of people have been infected throughout the world, but only 7 lakhs people die. How long we have to remain at the mercy of the virus? Surely, a fatal infection of the host is not in the long-term interest of the virus. The virus is continuously mutating and it suffers from selection pressure. The earlier coronaviruses, which still exist there, which infect people in the form of influenza, but not very seriously. But long back in 1888-89, they caused pandemic in the world and caused the death of almost 10 lakhs of people. Now this COVID-19 so far has caused the death of 7 lakhs people. The virologists expect that SARS-CoV-2 will also jump to another host or it will remain in the human body in attenuated form after some days. It may be expedited if vaccines are developed or any herd immunity is developed in the community. So the summary of my lecture is that the bats are assumed as the primary reservoir of SARS-like COVs, but bats SARS-like COVs lack the ability to bind to human receptor molecule AC2. So an intermediate host was necessary. Was it Sunda pangolin? There is a big question. We should be careful about our pets, because many of our pets can also be intermediate host. Even if they are not intermediate host, they definitely carry other viruses, not coronaviruses, that's other viruses, non-human coronaviruses, which can infect human beings and can be dangerous any day. probably some recombination took place in between some benign strain and some virulent strain, and the recent SARS-CoV-2 appeared. Now let us hope that the virus will relieve man soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for this wonderful session. You were excellently clear about the source, transmission, and pathogenicity of the coronavirus. Here we have some questions from the participants. I request you to help them with replies to their queries. The first question is asked from Dr. Soumen Sain, and he is asking, recently there are some cases where some mammals like tiger in a zoo are infected by SARS-CoV-2. Is it a case of a spillover? Then what is the possible source of spillover?
I mentioned this in my lecture, that there is a report in print media and electronic media that the tigers in New York, cat in Belgium, they have been infected. Definitely there is a spillover, but we cannot say right now how this spillover took place. So we have to be very careful about the animals in our vicinity, and also we have to study the wildlife and the interaction between wildlife and man very soon, because we have already crossed only 2 decades of this current century, and in these 2 decades we are having 3 outbreaks. We are having 8 more decades. So there may be outburst of any viruses from any animal sources in near future. So we have to be very careful about dog and to understand the spillover events.
Sir, there is one more question. It is asking, what is the strength of receptivity nature of antigen and antibody interaction during the control of SARS-CoV virus? It is from Dr. M. Salvi.
No, this is a very difficult question to answer, because the immunologists trying, and in fact those who are developing the vaccine, they are trying, because these bacteria, they have 4 structural proteins and many non-structural proteins, and they are continuously mutating. This is one of the difficulties of developing antigen, developing antibodies against the antigen, because so many proteins are there, and they, if they change, functionally change, and one antibody develops in the body of the host, and the protein changes, so another antibody will be required to counter the host. So it is a very tricky matter. So far, unless a vaccine comes into the market and it works successfully, we cannot say these antigen-antibody compatibility and the reaction.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I request Dr. Anjali Smita to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir, for the scholarly talk and beautifully bringing out the physiology of the COVID virus in a profound manner. I express my deep sense of appreciation for the brilliant presentation. Thank you so much, sir. We are indeed privileged to hear from you. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Emeritus Anilav Kaviraj. Thank you, Sister Principal and dear participants. Session 2 of this webinar will start at 11:45. Kindly enter 5 minutes before. Thank you very much. Respected dignitaries and dear participants, welcome back in the second session of the two-day national webinar on pandemic COVID-19, pathophysiology, prevention, and treatment. We all know that at this time, there are no specific vaccines, drugs, or treatment for COVID-19. Best way to protect us, to prevent infection. We have with us Dr. Ashok Kumar Sharma, Associate Professor, Department of Microbiology, RIMS, Ranchi, for session 2. He will tell us about diagnosis, prevention, and treatment of COVID-19. I request Dr. Manisha Kumari to introduce our honorable resource person, Dr. Ashok Kumar Sharma. Over to Dr. Manisha.
Thank you, Emma ma'am. Good morning, everyone. It is my privilege to introduce Dr. Ashok Kumar Sharma, Associate Professor, Department of Microbiology, RIMS, Ranchi, who with his team had taken the response to diagnose SARS-CoV-2 in our city. Day in and day out regularly. For this, with deepest sincerity, firstly, I want to thank you and your team, sir. Dr. Ashok Kumar Sharma had done his MBBS from MGM Medical College, Jamshedpur in 2001 and further done his MD in microbiology from Darbhanga Medical College and SGPGI Lucknow in 2008. Presently, he is serving his duties in RIMS Department of Microbiology since 2008. Dr. Ashok have published 40 publications in national and international journals, presented many research papers in national conferences, hosted 41 national conferences of Indian Association of Medical Microbiologists as Joint Organizing Secretary. Also, he is serving as co-principal investigator of VRDL, DHR and ICMR lab of RIMS, Ranchi, and serving as member of different committees of RIMS. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha. I request our esteemed resource person to begin this session.
Thank you, Dr. Manisha, for introducing me. First of all, good morning to Principal Nirmala College, Dr. Emma, HOD Department of Zoology, Dr. Anumati Singh, Department of Botany, and other faculty members of Nirmala College who participated in this webinar and participants of this webinar. Today's topic is a diagnosis of COVID-19 prevention and treatment. Basically, it is a very big topic I have chosen for this webinar, and in 1 hour session, very difficult to summarize, but I try to my best in 1 hour session how to diagnose, prevent and treatment of this COVID-19. Professor Kaviraj has nicely described the what is the coronavirus. Just I briefly first, Professor Kaviraj nicely described what is the coronavirus. Just I am in brief. It is an enveloped positive sense RNA virus which causes common cold to more severe diseases such as severe acute respiratory syndrome caused by SARS-CoV and Middle East respiratory syndrome. Now question is, what is SARS-CoV-2 and what is COVID-19? Basically, SARS-CoV-2 is a new coronavirus emerged in a Wuhan city, Hubei province in China, and known as a 2019 novel coronavirus. COVID-19 is a name given to the disease caused by the 2019 novel coronavirus. So, 11th May, WHO declared the COVID-19 a global public health emergency or global pandemic. Now come to topic diagnosis. How you diagnose COVID-19? Basically, this diagnosis depends on two ways. One is a provisional diagnosis and other is a confirmatory diagnosis. The provisional diagnosis depends upon the signs, symptoms and radiological examinations. It also depends on some hematological examinations, whereas confirmatory diagnosis is based RT-PCR, reverse transcriptase PCR, or real time PCR, which is a nowadays gold standard in a reverse for enhancing the strength of diagnosis or testing in our India. The TrueNAT and CBNAT are also included for the testing. In spite of this, nowadays antigen testing is also came for the diagnosis of COVID-19. It is also diagnosed by the serological examinations such as antibody testing, such as IgM antibody and IgG antibody. But it is not validated till now. It is under validation. Based on the signs and symptoms, we can diagnose what are the signs and symptoms. First symptoms is the fever, cough, sore throat, myalgia, shortness of breath, sputum. Upper respiratory symptoms like sore throat, rhinorrhea, and GI symptoms like diarrhea, nausea, which are seen in about 20% cases. Nowadays, it is also seen that some complaints occurs about the sudden loss of smell and taste. At the time of the pandemic, happening in China, the paper showed that most common symptoms are fever, which is 87.9%, then cough, followed by the fatigue, 38.1%, sputum, shortness of breath, which is 18.1%, myalgia, sore throat, headache, chills, vomiting, diarrhea. These are the common symptoms. Now question is, who are the more at risk? Basically, elderly people are more risk. And apart from the elderly people, those person who have the underlying health condition, such as hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and chronic respiratory disease, or person suffering from the cancer is also at more risk. And persons and women with pregnancy is also more risk. So they have to be the careful, they have to live carefully. Now, based on the provisional diagnosis, based on the radiological examination, the some paper showed that even RT-PCR negative can RT-PCR negative person show the CT scan finding, but not always. In some patient, it is find that some patient, although RT-PCR negative, they have some CT finding. On the CT finding, basically more common finding is the glass ground appearance, which is multifocal, bilateral, peripheral, but nearly early phase unifocal. In the late phase, it is a multifocal, bilateral, and in the early phase, a unifocal, commonly located in the inferior lobe of the right lung. The brown mass appearance is the white, is a bilateral brown mass opacity with posterior prominence. Posterior lobe means more predominant. Other findings including are crazing paving, vascular dilatation, traction bronchiectasis. These are the CT scan finding. On the basis of this, we can say the person is suffering from the COVID-19. But this is not confirmatory. So confirmatory diagnosis, we have to rely on the RT-PCR. For the confirmatory diagnosis, we have two things. First of all, we have to detect the viral RNA. The viral RNA is detected by the RT-PCR or NAT. NAT is a nucleic acid amplification test, or RT-PCR is a reverse transcriptase or real-time PCR, polymerase chain reaction. Apart nowadays, at present, COVID-19 viral antigen is also came for the diagnosis of COVID-19 and is a very rapid. It is a rapid test. It takes about half an hour, whereas RT-PCR it takes about 6 to 8 hours. So it is a very easy, and COVID-19 viral antigen detects the part of the viruses like spikes, envelopes, membranes. The serological tests are also under the process of validation. These serological tests are detect the antibodies which is present in the serum of the patient. There are two types of antibodies, which are IgM antibodies and IgG antibodies. IgM antibody indicates the recent infection, whereas the IgG antibody indicates the past infection. For the testing of the COVID-19 infection, the timing is very important. This graph shows that there is some incubation period. It is 2 to 14 days of the COVID-19 infection. After infection, the incubation period is 2 to 14 days. That means after infection, the first sign and symptoms come after 2 days or maximum 14 days. So the timing is very important when we have to collect the samples for the RT-PCR or antibody testing or even antigen testing. So in this picture, it is so that in between incubation period, from the mid of the incubation period, where the signs and symptoms are more, and at that time the detection of the virus is more, and serological testing is done where the antibody formation is occurs. It will occur over the mid. It occurs in the mid sign and symptoms. For the testing of the COVID-19, we have to collect the samples. What are the samples we should take? Basically, at present, we are taking the throat swab or oropharyngeal swabs, nasal swabs in the VTM, viral transport medium. VTM has it contains a medium in which we put the swabs. At present, both the swabs are put in the same VTM so that viral load is being increased. Both for RT-PCR and TrueNAT or CBNAT. For the RT-PCR, we take the two swabs, but for the TrueNAT or CBNAT, we take the only one swabs, one nasopharyngeal swabs. For the antigen detection, we also take the one swab, which is a nasal pharyngeal swabs. What are the other samples we should take in case bronchoalveolar lavage? If the patient is unable to take from the oropharyngeal or nasopharyngeal swab, in that case we take the bronchoalveolar swab, tracheal aspirate, even we also take the sputum. In confirmed case, we also take the blood and stool and urine. The RT-PCR is a very lengthy process. It contains multiple steps for the detection of COVID-19 or COVID-19 coronavirus, a novel coronavirus. The first step is a extraction of the RNA. It is a RNA virus, so first step we extract the RNA. There is some steps, so multiple steps. We extract the RNA, from that RNA we amplify, and after amplification we detect. So at present, the RT-PCR is a qualitative assay, not as a quantitative assay. It is a qualitative assay, and only we detect the target gene are present or not. So as in the earlier session, Professor Kaviraj nicely told, the so many coronavirus are present in the environment. So first of all, we screen by targeting the E gene, envelope gene, which that indicates that the coronavirus are present or not. After that, if the person is suffering from the E gene, person in which we detect the E gene, in that case we confirm by targeting the IDRP gene or N gene or ORF gene. If either N gene or F gene or RDRP genes are present or detected, then we say the person is suffering from COVID-19. The persons are infected with COVID-19. Now come to the infection prevention and control. As we know that prevention is better than cure. So for prevention of the COVID-19, prevention and control is a very, very important. This picture shows that who is at risk of infection. This picture shows that nobody is exempted. Everyone is infected. As in the news, we say that so many mantris and filmmakers, actors are also infected. So it is not a disease of rich, poor. Everyone is infected. What is the mode of transmission? There is a mode of transmission. Is a airborne transfer, droplet infection, aerosol or direct contact. So aerosol, if aerosol is more than 5 micrometer, then it will travel 1 meter, less than 1 meter. Aerosol is less than five micrometer, it will travel more than 1 meter. So even the our prime minister make a distance of 2 gaj, that is about 1 meter. So it is very important to make a distance. Social distancing is very, very important, and it also transmit from one person to other by direct contact, either in hands or other surfaces. So for the prevention, we should safe practice in the community. So how we prevent the transmission of the COVID-19 or infection of the coronavirus infection by hand hygiene, respiratory hygiene, social distancing, and high risk group. Special care to given high risk group, such as the patient suffering from the heart disease, diabetes, hypertension, should avoid in contact with the person who is suffering from the coronavirus. One important thing, how to find and break the chain of the transmission. It is very, very important how to break the chain of transmission. Nowadays, most of the countries, it is controlled. But in our country, the number of patients are increasing so much. So for the breaking of chain, first of all, we have to isolate or identify the patient who is suffering from the cough, fever, shortness of breath, and test the person. Identify the person, then isolate them and treat them. After testing, if it is a positive, we have to treat them. After that, we have to make a list of the who came in contact with the positive patient. So we have to do the contact tracing and quarantine them either in home or COVID centers. We have to monitor the contacts daily so that if there is any sign or symptom developed, they will be tested and treated. How can we avoid getting infected? Simply, it is due by hand washing or hand hygiene. We have to wash our hands with soap and water 40 seconds, especially after we have been public place or other blowing your nose, coughing or sneezing. These are the common habits. We blow nose and we don't wash the hand. If soap and water not available, we use the hand sanitizer 70% alcohol. If soap and water not available, cover all surface of the hands and rub them together until they feel dry. We should avoid touch our eyes, nose, mouth with unwashed hand. If we should avoid to touch the surface like doors, knobs, doorbells, elevators, button, handrail support, etc. If it is a necessary touch, we have to sanitize all those. Respiratory hygiene is very, very important. We should not use covering of our face like pallu or sari or chuni or gamcha. Basically, we should use the proper mask. And if you want to blow or cough, we have to cough at proper places, and we have to throw the tissue paper or in a closed dustbin. If you want to sneeze, and if don't use both hands, we have to use the arm for sneezing so that our hands are uncontaminated. After we have to wash hands immediately after covered our sneeze or cough. And next thing is the social distancing. It is a very, very important. We have to make about 2 feet distance or 1 meter distance. We have to stay, and we have to avoid gathering or melas or any places where so many people are gathered. We should not go there. Apart from these social or community awareness, we have to clean the environment. We have to disinfect the environment. And one of the most important things are biomedical waste management. This biomedical waste management for the hospitals or for the healthcare personnel. For environmental decontamination, we have to clean the surfaces hand hygiene is important to minimize the impact of this transfer. So hand hygiene is very, very important. Cleaning and disinfecting the environmental surface is a fundamental in reducing the health care associated infections. COVID-19 virus, it survives 1 to 2 days on the porous surface, whereas 8 to 12 hours on the non-porous surface. So it is a very important, if any positive patient or any contamination occur on the porous or non-porous surfaces, we have to clean or disinfect premises and other areas which are potentially contaminated to be cleaned before they are reused. The environment should be cleaned with water and detergent. After that, we have to clean the sodium hypochlorite 0.5% or ethanol 70%. For the healthcare personnel, or if any ambulance carry the positive patient, we have to also sanitize the ambulance by 1% hypochlorite solution by using NASPAC sprayers. And the person who will sanitize the ambulance, they also wear the proper PPE. Proper cleaning and disinfection of the occupied patient room is a very, very important. Cleaning and disinfection of the medical equipment is also very important. If you any healthcare person go to the the patient room and use the stethoscope, thermometers, BP. They have to, if they do not sanitize or clean, it will the cross contamination, it contaminate the other person or even the healthcare personnel, even the doctor. So we have to clean the stethoscopes by alcohol-based rub or spit, BP cups, detergent hot water, thermometers with a detergent hot water, alcohol rub, injection and dressing trolley, detergent and water. All these should be the clean so that it will avoid the contamination of the other person, even the doctors or healthcare personnel. I have already told you the disposal of the biomedical waste is a very, very important. So now it is a common practice. It is a common practice that take the samples and open the PP kit and throw it in the dustbin. So it is a very hazardous. Proper biomedical waste management or proper disposal of the mask, PP kit, gloves, which is used for the collection of the samples, it is a very, very important. Otherwise, it is a potential source of the contamination. So there is some guideline. Before discarding all these, we have to autoclave. Otherwise, we cannot discard as it is. But it is a very difficult in a practice. Practically, it is a not always discarded all the things by autoclaving. It is possible in the institutes like RIMS and other hospitals, but even the more common hospitals, in the smaller hospitals, it is very difficult to autoclave all those PPE kit, masks, gloves. So there is some guideline for disposal of the biomedical waste. There is some color-coded dustbins or bags are available in which it is some types of the material which is given, such as in yellow, which is a non-colored color-coded bag in colored bins. And in this human or animal anatomical waste, soil waste, expired or discarded medicines, microbiotic, clinical lab waste, chemical liquids are discarded. And the final disposal is incineration or deep burial. If you discard the biomedical waste in the yellow bin, the finally you have to incinerate or deep burial. In the red bag, which is a non-coordinated plastic bags in colored bins container, it contains, you have to discard the contaminated waste, which is a recyclable, such as a tubings, bottles, urine bags, syringes without needles and gloves. And it should be the autoclave or hydro by micro and then sent to the recycling. First of all, discontaminated by the materials which is given in the discarding in the red bags. First of all, we have to autoclave, then it should be sent to recyclable machine. White bags, it is a translucent, puncture or leak or tamper proof. Waste sharp metals, instrument like the syringes, needles of the syringes are discarded in the white bags. And these are the auto or dry heat sterilization followed by shredding. It is also shredding, but nowadays shredding is inhibited. Now come to the blue bags, waterproof and cardboard boxes container. Glassware waste will be discarded in a blue bag. This now, what is the benefit of the infection prevention and control? So, it is a very important for protecting ourselves. If you maintain the procedure of the infection control and prevention and control, that means we have to protect ourselves and protect patient. By protecting all these, we have to protect our family, community and the environment. So infection control prevention and control is very, very important in the controlling the spread of COVID-19. What are the general advice for the COVID-19? General advice is avoid the close contact with the people suffering from the acute respiratory syndrome or infection. Any person who is suffering from the flu-like symptoms, cough, cold, please avoid in close contact of those person. Frequent hand hygiene, especially after direct contact with all people or their environment. If you suspect any person contaminate the surfaces or table or chairs, please sanitize all the hand, wash your hands and sanitize all those materials, then reuse. People with the symptoms of acute respiratory infection should practice. If any person who have suffering from the acute respiratory infection, they have to practice the respiratory etiquettes and shishtachar, wear a medical mask, seek medical care for advice. If they are doing like this, it will protect community. This is for the treatment and healthcare personnel. If you go to treat the patient, we have to maintain the hand hygiene by 5 moments. Before touching a patient, we have to wash our hands before touching the patients. Before cleaning, clean or aseptic procedure. If you do any injection, if any procedure, we have to clean or if there is any exposure of body fluids, then we have to clean our hands after touching a patient. If you touch the patient of the then we wash our hands. If you touch the any things which are present in the patient room, like beds, handle, chairs, so after that we also have to clean our hand. There is a certain methods how to wash our hands. For hands, first of all we use the soap and water. For soap and water we use 40 to 60 seconds, and if you use alcohol based rub, then you use for 20 to 30 seconds. There are some methods for hand hygiene. For this we use a mnemonic Suman Ki. S indicates the Siddha, that means the palm of the hands. U indicates the Ulta, that means the dorsum of the hand. M Mutthi, that means the like this Mutthi. And if A indicates the Anguta, like this one, this is the Anguta. N indicates the Nakhun, and K indicates the Klai. So this is the very important how to wash our hands. First of all, this is the Siddha Suman, S for Siddha. This is the Ulta, this one. A for M for Mutthi, like this. We have to wash our hands like this. And Nakhun, then the Kalai, this is the last step. Both in the, if you use soap and water, like same, or if you want to use a sanitizer, hand sanitizer or alcohol-based sanitizer, in the same, but the only difference is that in alcohol-based sanitizer, we have to use 20 to 30 seconds, whereas in soap and water, we have to use 40 to 60 seconds. In a respiratory hygiene or etiquette or a shishtachar, this is a common practice. We sneeze the nose with a tissue paper and throw here and there. This is a very bad practice. So we have to throw the tissue paper or anything after a sneeze in a proper dustbin. During the sneeze or cough, we have to cover our nose or mouth with a tissue paper or any handkerchiefs. If we use a tissue paper, discard immediately into the trash or any proper dustbin. And one more thing, if nothing is available, so if during the sneeze or cough, we use the arm of the hands like this, so that your forearm and hands are not contaminated. So this is a common practice, and it is a very important practice how to prevent our hands or arm hands or forearm being contaminated. After cough or sneeze, we have to wash our hands with either soap and water or alcohol based. When it is very important, if our hands are soiled, then we must use the soap and water. If it is not soiled hands, then we use alcohol based sanitizer. Now come to the home care of the patient with suspected COVID-19 infection with a mild symptoms. Nowadays, at present, in our country, the number of cases are increasing very fast. Today's scenario is about 62,000 cases are occurred in all over India, and earlier it is same number of cases occur in the America, but now the trend in America is the number of cases are decreased, and in the world, India is the third country with the number of cases occur. So, and number of beds are available in our country are going to short. So it is now advisable that if the person, even the patient with the COVID-19 positive and no symptoms, they are home quarantined, isolated in the home. So it is a very, very important to how to care the patient who are quarantined or isolated in the home. So patient in the well ventilated room, first of all, if the single room is available, then keep the patient in the single room which are well ventilated. Give the patient a medical mask, either N95. If N95 masks are not available, give the surgical mask. Limit the movement of the patient and give the patient in the warm room and advise them not to move more. Limit the movement of that patient. Minimize the shared space. And we should not share the same space. If possible, household members should stay in the different room. If that is not possible, then maintain a distance of at least 1 meter from the ill person. That means we do not share the same bed. We should use a separate bed. We should also give a limited number of caregivers, family member or paid helper. If you don't use more than 1, 2, or 4 person to care the positive patient, limited one person, so that if the attendant or caregiver will be positive, the other person will be there. Visitors should not be allowed in his room. And again, hand hygiene is very important. If you go to the patient room, don't touch anything in that room. If you touch, then again immediately clean the environment and wash your hands. Before preparing the food, always wash. Hand hygiene is very important, and always wash. Before eating, after using the toilet, and whenever hands look dirty, wash our hands. Caregivers should also wear a tightly fitted medical mask that covers their mouth and nose when the same room as in the patient. If there is any body fluids, avoid direct contact with that body fluids, such as urine or sputum, sneeze. So avoid contact, direct contact with this body fluids, so that the caregivers will be protected. We should use the disposable gloves and mask when providing oral or respiratory care to the patient, or when handling the urine, stool, and other waste. We should always perform the hand hygiene before and after moving the gloves and mask. Use of mask at home. It is a very important an individual with suspected infection with mild respiratory symptoms. Caregivers should also given the mask on any relatives. If you want to visit the patient room, they should give the mask. Along the mask, we should always perform the hand hygiene. We should maintain the distance of 1 meter. We should maintain the airflow in the living space by opening windows as much as possible. And mask management. What is a mask management? It is a very important. Two things is important in the case of the mask management. Those who are their healthcare personnel, who are doctors, nurses, paramedical staffs, they have a different mask management, and the persons and the home care. In the home care is a different. So if we are doctor, we should wear the mask. So there is a certain method of the wearing the mask. So different type of masks are available. At present, I have this mask. We have to wear, we have to hold the mask by thread like this and wear the mask. We should avoid the touching the front of the mask. If I am the home care person and I am the caregiver of the patient, if we want to visit the patient room, then the front of the mask are contaminated. So don't touch the front of the mask. If you want to discard the mask, so we remove the mask by putting the thread on behind the ear, and like this I remove the mask. So this is the way how to remove the mask. This is the one thing for the healthcare personnel, home caregivers. For the patient is already infected, so inside the mask is a contaminated, outside less contaminated than inside. So never touch inside the mask. In case of the other or home care, don't touch the outside the mask. Mask should also use in the community settings. If the individuals without respiratory symptoms, we should avoid close crowded space, maintain distance of 1 meter, we have to practice hand and respiratory hygiene, refrain from the touching face, nose, mouth. And earlier there is no need of mask, but now it is essential to wear the mask. Even the surgical mask or mask of the clothes is necessary to wear in the community setting, because nobody knows which are infected. Now the number of cases are increasing so high. So it is not exactly there is a community spread, but somehow it is a community spread occurs. So now, and there is a guideline of the also state government or central government has come, we wear the mask even we are the mask for everyone is essential. So now we have to wear the mask in the community basis also, not for the surgical, not necessary the medical mask. Even you have to use the surgical or mask of the clothes. If the person who is the respiratory symptoms, then must wear the medical mask and they have to seek the medical care and they should know the mask management. Everybody, preventive action for everyone. Preventive action is not prevent the ourselves, but if you protect ourselves, it is also for other person. So everybody, prevention is action for everyone. So it is important hand hygiene, coughing and sneezing, how to cough and sneeze and how to discard, prepare food safely and avoid spitting in the public places. If any symptoms occur, they should seek the medical care. We have to avoid the touching our face, eyes, nose. We should avoid the close contact with the symptomatic cases. And this is a very important. Do not handshake. Avoid the handshakes. Instead of handshake, say namaste. So it is a logically, why say the namaste in spite of handshake? So this picture shows handshake contains or transfer 124 million bacterial colony. So if you do the handshake, that means 124 million. These are bacterial, but almost same virus will be transferred from one person to other person. If you handshake like this, 55 million bacterial colony occurs, transfer will occur. If you do like this bump, 7 million bacterial colony will transfer. And if you do the namaste, there is a zero bacterial colony transfer occur. So handshake, so namaste is a very important than handshake. Now come to the last part, is the treatment of the COVID-19. The treatment of the COVID-19 is no specific treatment for nowadays. As such, no specific antiviral therapy occur. So we should treat the patient on the basis of symptoms, such as a fever, difficulty in breathing, and suppose a person is a complaint of fever, we should give the paracetamol for the control of fever. If there is a difficulty in breathing, we can give the oxygen. And if there is a patient needs some more thing, if the patient is hypotensive, then we go for the fluid. If the patient occur a breathlessness, we go for the oxygen therapy. And There is some research says that hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin are some beneficial in the reduction of the viral load of the COVID-19. So clinically, for the management of the COVID-19 RT-PCR positive patient, we have clinically divided the patient in five groups. One is the asymptomatic patient, so the mild symptomatic, moderate symptomatic, severe and critical patient. Asymptomatic means a person who have no symptoms, mild means a person with a uncomplicated upper respiratory tract infections, such as a sore throat, sneeze, sputum. Moderate, person suffering from the pneumonia with no signs of severe disease, and a severe pneumonia, and a severe category includes the severe pneumonia and critical condition of person suffering from the ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndromes, or even a septic shock. So management depends upon these five categories. It is a very important those person who want to manage the patient, they should wear the personal protective equipments, PPE. for the treatment for the symptomatic patient, we should give the supportive therapy. And supportive therapy such as like if patient suffering from the fever, we give the paracetamol. If cough, then we give the expectorant or antidepressant, cough depressant. In support, apart from this, we have to give the zinc 15 mg OD for 7 days, tablet vitamin C 500 mg, thrice daily for 7 days. If there is a cough, then we have to N-style cysteine thrice a day. These are the gifts, the zinc or vitamins to immune, to develop the more immunity and strengthen the body strength. Now, come the in case of the mild cases, as there is a now antiviral, the some research says the some antiviral are a mild beneficial, not yet. The tablet hydroxychloroquine is given 400 mg BD for one day, and then followed by the 200 mg twice day for 4 days for the patient. It is also given in the home care and in the COVID care centers. But before giving the hydroxychloroquine, it is essential to check the ECG because because sometimes there is a bad result of the hydroxychloroquine occur. So this is a must before taking the hydroxychloroquine. If you want to give in anti viral therapy, a tablet favipiravir at 100 mg twice a day is a given, followed by 800 mg twice a day for 6 days. Patient with a heart disease should be avoided the hydroxychloroquine. In this case, if a patient is suffering from the heart disease, then in this condition we have to give the doxycycline and ivermectin. If the patient comes under the moderate condition in this category, then antiviral therapy. Give remdesivir 200 mg IV on day 1, followed by the 100 mg IV daily for 4 days. If remdesivir is not available, then we have to start hydroxychloroquine for 400 mg BD for 1 day, followed by 200 mg twice daily for 4 days. Co-administration of the injection remdesivir with HCG or chloroquine should be the avoided. In this condition, we have to give the steroid injection like the methylprednisolone 0.5 to 1 mg per kg body weight, injection dexamethasone 0.1 mg, 0.1 to 2 mg per kg body weight for 3 days. If there is any intravascular coagulation occurs or suspected, there are signs and symptoms occur in intravascular coagulation, then we have to give the anticoagulant injection or enoxaparin 40 mg subcutaneous OD for 7 days. If in a moderate condition, if antibiotic according to local antibiotic, and we have to also supplement the antibiotic. So antibiotic is given about the local antibiogram. What is the local antibiogram means? If you, I am living in the Ranchi. That means the trend of antibiotics, which antibiotics in the Ranchi is sensitive or resistant, there should be present. Suppose in RIMS, we have the antibiogram, which suppose an example of the UTI, urinary tract infection. In case of UTI, the trend of UTI is caused by Klebsiella, Escherichia coli, so many bacteria are responsible for the UTI. But in case of the UTI caused by Klebsiella pneumoniae, all the chloroquinolones are almost resistant. So no use of the fluoroquinolones even and the other antibiotic. Most of the Klebsiella pneumoniae are resistant to the fluoroquinolones. So if you give the fluoroquinolones in case of the Klebsiella pneumoniae UTI, it is a no use. A patient will not respond. So every hospital or institute should have the antibiogram. According to this antibiogram, we have to start the antibiotics to those patients. Otherwise, we have to, after culture sensitivity test, we have to give the exact antibiotic, which is a sensitive, which is a resistant. If there is any need of the oxygen, then we have to give the oxygen supply through the nasal prongs, 2 to 5 liters per minute, or face mask 5 liters per minute. If the patient will not respond, then we can treat the patient with the convalescent plasma therapy. That means, what is the convalescent plasma therapy? Nowadays, not so many advertisement comes by administration. Is donate the plasma to person who donate the plasma. Advertisement are coming, encourage to make a blood bank and encourage the patient who have recovered from the COVID-19 to donate the plasma. So, conventional plasma after recovery, basically what happens after the attack of the COVID-19 or infection of the coronavirus, novel coronavirus, our body immune system make the antibodies against this infection. So, initially it formed the IgM. That if you find the IgM antibody, that means there is a recent infection. If you find the IgG antibodies, that means that they have the past infection. So these antibodies are capable of invading the infection to the person. If you provide the conventional plasma to the patient who is not responding to the other medicine, that will this plasma contains the antibody that will fight the virus which are present in the blood and other parts of the body, that will and help the patient in a recovery. In case of the severe or critical condition, we have give the injection of the tocilizumab 8 mg per kg, maximum 800 mg at one time, given slowly in the 100 ml NS over 1 hour. Dose can be repeated once after 12 to 24 hours if needed, or injection itolizumab 1 ST dose, 1.6 mg per kg dose in infusion. Subsequent dose weekly 0.8 mg per kg body weight dose infusion over 4 hours if required. Estroid, it is a supplement with the estroid injection of methylprednisolone or dexamethasone. It is, in this case, critical cases anticoagulants are essential to give. And again, the antibiotic is a given ceftriaxone as an empirical therapy. And after that, according to antibiogram, then if any sepsis occurs after culture sensitivity, blood culture sensitivity, we give the exact antibiotics. If there is a need of the oxygen, so there is a various mode of giving the oxygen. So we have to give the oxygen like a face mask or NRM, non-rebreathing mask. In patient deteriorates with this FNSE or a non-invasive trial of the giving the oxygen, we repeat the AVG, arterial blood gas analysis 6 hourly, and the patient is supplemented to the artificial ventilation. Or the patient will be supplemented with the ARDS NET protocol of the ventilation. Then patient also given for the supplement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, we are really grateful to you for sharing these valuable informations to us, imparting these ideas and knowledges about COVID-19. We have received some questions from the participants. I would like you to reply them.
Yes, ma'am.
First question is, does the RT-PCT test is sufficient to detect the SARS-CoV-2 infection, or we have to use all other IgM or IgG serological tests to detect them?
Ma'am, basically RT-PCR is a gold standard test and its sensitivity is about 90 to 95%. Whereas you have to question about the IgG or IgM antibody test, it is not validated now. Only antigen test, detection test is validated and it is available in the most of the cities or country, most of the states of our country, even in Jharkhand it is available. So in RT-PCR is a confirmatory test. So beyond this test, we go for the sequencing for the screen purposes. So RT-PCR is a mainly test we can use nowadays for the testing of this COVID-19.
Thank you, sir. There is another question. Yeah, if a patient tests positive for another respiratory virus, should that exclude SARS-CoV-2 as a cause of illness? And when can patient with a confirmed COVID-19 case can be released?
Ma'am, basically now at present so many cases of the COVID-19 are coming. All the governments are directed to do the test of the COVID-19 only. Otherwise, like swine flu is also earlier, whereas not as much case are doing testing, we use the also swine flu testing. But we are not doing the swine flu testing now because huge number of cases are present and there's a lot of time to take by RT-PCR. So on the basis of clinical sense or clinical based diagnosis, we can exclude. But there is a havoc in a common public. They are suffering from the COVID-19. It's very difficult to exclude. There are mentally and a psychological problem for them. So better to exclude the corona by doing RT-PCR or antigen test or either by mini PCR such as the CVNet or TrueNet.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for this wonderful session. Thank you, Sister Principal, for being with us. Thank you, dear participants. Our session 3 will start at 3 p.m. But before we leave, I would request Dr. Manisha Kumari to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, MMM. Thank you, sir, for enhancing our knowledge so nicely about the diagnosis, prevention, and possible treatment of COVID-19. It was indeed a great opportunity to hear your views. Thank you so much.
So please join 5 minutes before for session 3, which will be starting at 3 p.m. Thank you very much. Respected dignitaries, resource person, and dear participants,
A warm good afternoon. Our patron and Principal Nirmala College, Dr. Sister Jyoti, is with us. This is the third session of the online national webinar on pandemic COVID-19, pathophysiology, prevention and treatment. Session 1 and 2 of the webinar have given us insight on sources of transmission, pathogenicity, diagnosis, treatment and prevention from disease. As prevention is the best remedy and improving our immunity is the best mode of prevention, let us welcome Dr. Sudarshan Maurya, Senior Scientist, ICAR, Indian Institute of Vegetable Research, Varanasi, as our esteemed resource person of this session, who will be helping us to select the immunity booster food in the wake of pandemic COVID-19. I request Dr. Neetu Rani, Assistant Professor, Botany Department, Nirmala College, Ranchi, to introduce our esteemed resource person.
Dr. Emma, ma'am, good afternoon to all. It is my proud privilege to introduce our resource person, Dr. Sudarshan Maurya. Dr. Sudarshan Maurya did his PhD from Banaras Hindu University. Dr. Maurya has a specialization in plant pathology. He had 6 years research teaching experience and 14 years research experience. He has published 85 research articles in national and international journals of repute. He has patented neem-based as well as cow urine-based formulation having antimicrobial efficiency. He has been awarded Best Distinguished Scientist Award and Best Extension Scientist in Mushroom Cultivation in Eastern India. Earlier, he was senior scientist at ICAR Research Complex for Eastern Region, Palandu, Ranchi. Presently, he is working as senior scientist at ICAR Indian Institute of Vegetable Research, Saharanpur, Varanasi, Uttar Pradesh. On the behalf of entire fraternity of Nirmala College, I, Dr. Neetu Rani, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, welcome you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Neetu. I request honorable resource person to begin the session's talk. Over to Dr. Sudarshan Maurya.
Very good afternoon. Today I am here with a webinar on which the topic will be related to booster foods to wake up COVID. In the lecture, I will cover following points: immunity and their types, factor affecting the immunity, diet and immunity, immunity booster foods, vegetables, fruits, herbs and spices, herbal preparations like kadha, extract, etc. First of all, we must know why immunity is important during COVID. As we know, our immune system is the most important line of defense against various diseases causing microorganisms. It is programmed to identify and protect us from various type of threats. Many symptoms that we actually associated with the disease are the work of the immune. The immune system is a set of composite network of cells and protein that protect our body from germs and infection. It keeps the record of each a germ that the system has destroyed so that it can recognize and defend the germs immediately the next time they try to enter our body.
The arrival of COVID has finally led us to realizing the importance of having immunity check. It has been demonstrated that it is a person's immune system is strong, the fetal virus will not be able to harm the individual easily. This is perhaps the reason why most of the deaths that have occurred in case of COVID-19, COVID people who were either old or had some sort of chronic illness. What is immunity? First, we know what is immunity. Immunity is a system of biological structure that processes within an organism that help to protect our bodies from harmful diseases causing pathogens. The ability of an organism to resist a particular infection or toxin produced by disease causing pathogens by the action of specific antibodies or sensitized white blood cells. If our immunity is strong or become induced or acquired, we can protect from the various kinds of pathogens like viruses, bacteria, fungi, etc. If you go in detail, our immunity are two types. Innate immunity means pre-existing immunity, which we have. Adaptive immunity means acquired immunity, which we generate or acquired by various kinds of foods, various kinds of stresses, like that. And I will give you the detail about innate immunity. The innate immunity responses is the first line of defense against infectious micro-invader. It provides a quick response to these pathogens, though a variety of different mechanisms, utilizing everything from physical barrier, such as your skin and mucus, to cytokine production and complement activation. These methods are all part of the primary immune system response after an initial encounter with a new pathogen. Both cytokine production and complementation activation help to recruit immune cells to a site of infection and induce an inflammatory tissue response, which provide protection against various pathogens or invaders like viruses. Moreover, acquired adaptive immunity. In contrast, the adaptive immunity system responds slowly over a day and uses custom-made receptors that detect foreign invader via their specific antigen. This is a slower process that results from the combined effect of lymphocyte, T cells, B cells, and natural killer cells, T cells. They work together to specifically detect and mark a pathogen or site as a threat using a specialized antibody. They then amplify the response and destroy the invader. Scientists now realizing that the immunity is the key to fighting against the viruses. The person with a good immunity power or defense system can heal himself partially and protect from these viruses. So until the researcher found the adequate vaccine to the diseases, the health workers and leaders of the world are focusing on the way to boost immunity. Yoga and Ayurveda are the two sure way to enhance the immunity of the body and build a strong defense system inside our body. diet and immunity. Diet and immunity has positive correlation. If our diet is good, our immunity certainly becomes better and better. So adequate nutrition is vital for healthy immune system. If we have a nutrient deficiency, our immunity becomes inferior or become poor. However, innate and acquired immunity is affected by malnutrition. Some foods can stimulate energy production in susceptible people. What are the healthy way to strengthen our immunity system? Your first line of defense is choose a healthy lifestyle. Following general good health guidelines is the single best step you can take towards naturally keeping your immune system strong and healthy. Every part of our body, including our immune system, functions better when protected from environmental assaults and bolstered with healthy living strategies such as these. If we are a smoker, then we go to stop the smoking. Don't smoke. Eat a diet high in fruits and vegetables and whole grains. Restrict saturated fatty acids and sugars to our total calorie more than 10%. Minimizing consumption of red flakes or processed meat. Exercise regularly about 20 to 25 minutes a day, like walking, jogging, cycling, like that. Try to get 150 minutes of moderate activity a day. Control your blood pressure. At least we think about regularly we check up our blood pressure. If all your blood pressure going high, then try to minimize. And if our blood pressure is lower, then try to accommodate normal BP. Moreover, maintain healthy weight and medical screening regularly. Get adequate sleep and take steps to avoid infections such as washing your hands frequently and cooking meat thoroughly if you are non-vegetarian. Try to minimize stresses. See the pictures, how to build immunity against coronavirus. If you are getting good sleep, 6 to 8 hours. If you are using garlic, raw garlic, 1 to 2 cloves in a day in our meal. If we are using exercise regularly, we are taking adequate water, become our body hydrated, avoid refined sugar, and avoid smoking. It will give and boost up your immunity. It will protect your body from various invaders like coronavirus, bacteria, fungi, etc. These are the previous things which I discussed in the previous slide. But healthy food, why it is important? Because we know vegetables and fruits are resource of minerals, vitamins, as well as our primary nutrients like protein, carbohydrate, amino acids, fats, etc. We can stop the corona viruses transmission by using the pictures. If you go to wash your hand frequently, if you are sneezing, use your arm. If you are using tissue paper, dispose it in disposable boxes. Avoid to contact the people by handshaking. Avoid to go in crowd gathering or public meetings. Don't touch your eyes, clean your faces frequently by using tissue paper. Don't use public transport. Use Arogya Setu app on mobile. If you are showing some symptoms like fever, flu, cough, you can isolate yourself and try to work from home and use mask whenever you are going outside. What are the immunity system booster foods? Immunity system, as you know, if you have good nutrient, which includes fruits, protein, carbohydrate, viruses, along with minerals. Minerals play important role in the immune system. It is generally advised to eat healthy, balanced diet, rich in fruits and vegetables, which allow us to get these nutrients through our foods. In addition, to healthy eating, being physically active, reducing stresses, and getting enough sleep, it also will provide normal immune function. As we discussed previously, garlic plays an important role in our body because it has a lysine compound which provides immunity booster as well as anti-allergic. If you are using garlic, first you take a garlic and chop it and keep for 3 to 5 minutes. Then you go for eat garlic, because after keeping 2 to 4 minutes, enzyme activates, it produces LSM. That LSM is helpful for immunity booster as well as anti-allergic to your body. Here I am showing the 10 health benefits of garlic. If you are using garlic, it will provide better healing protection, add headache and dizziness, regulate blood pressure, muscle decongestion, assist arthritis. It has antimicrobial property, so protect your body from the microbes. It has anti-cancerous property. If you are using regularly garlic, raw food, it will provide protection against cancer. It has natural antiviral properties. So if you are using garlic in our diet regularly, it will provide antiviral property to protect our body from the viruses. It has antifungal property. It has painkiller also. Moreover, as per the immunity booster foods, some foods are natural foods. We are very much known about mushrooms. Mushroom, as per Arizona State University Journal 2010, it provides that it increases immunity system. If you are using mushrooms, or consuming mushrooms in our diet, it has anti-cancerous benefits. It has many nutritional benefits, which provide vitamin C, D, and B. It has resource of minerals, selenium, iron, magnesium, phosphorus, potassium, and zinc. It also relieves from high cholesterol level, prostate cancer, and anti-diabetes. It also helps in weight loss. It provides good bone health, because it has source of vitamin D. Mushrooms are the resource of calcium also. These are the mushrooms which are using. If we are using in our diet, it will provide better health. If you eating mushrooms, it has 6% protein, dietary fiber 4%, carbohydrate 1%, calories, minimum calories, providing foods are here. It has very rich source of vitamins, riboflavin, niacin, pentathenic acid, vitamin D5, B3, and it has resource of minerals, which will provide various kinds of health benefits as showing in the slides. Here I am giving example of some medicinal mushrooms which will provide health benefits like shiitake, which is also known as Japanese mushroom, which is very much popular in the 5-star culinary uses, are known for their immune supportive benefits. They are rich source in vitamins and minerals, appear to enhance immune function and lower inflammation. They also have antiviral and anti-cancerous property. Moreover, like Western mushroom, as you know, Jharkhand is the leading Western mushroom producer. Western mushrooms containing high amount of carbothionine, naturally occurring antioxidants. This simply means they are able to prevent free radical damage in the body. In addition, they are an excellent source of selenium, a nutrient needed for immune system for better function. Selenium helps to regulate production of immunoglobulins, and they enhance activity of certain white blood cells called natural killer cells, and also considered as a heart healthy fungus. Now I will give you some important fruits and vegetables which will provide antioxidant property, which will provide helpful in immunity boosting to our system body. Like here I am showing the nimbu, lemon fruits like oranges, kinno, nimbu, so lemons, lime. These, if you are consuming such type of fruits in our daily diet, it will provide vitamin C, antioxidant to our body. It also provides protection against allergy and minor infestation of the invader like fungus, bacteria, and viruses. Adrak, turmeric, these are the prominent antioxidant as well as immunity booster. Here next to the slides, if you are using fresh ginger in our foods, it will provide protection as compared to dried ginger, which will provide the protection against cell lysis, while in dry ginger it cannot. Sweet potato, it has beta carotene rich foods. It will provide minerals and vitamin B6. It will provide protection against inflammation. Apples, it will provide immunity in our body as well as anti-allergic reactions. Like that, linseed, it has very good energy booster as well as immunity booster. It has selenium and omega-3 fatty acids. If you are using 1 spoon of roasted linseed powder with a warm glass of milk, it will provide very good health as well as very good immunity too. Like that, vitamin C, if we consuming capsicum, Shimla mirch, it has very good source of vitamin C, as well as it has beta carotene. If you are using Shimla mirch in our diet, it induces our immunity. As I discussed in the previous slides, almost all kinds of fruits and vegetables provide various vitamins like vitamin C, vitamin D, as well as it will provide beta carotenes that transform into protein quickly, as well as it will provide protection against fungal and bacterial and viruses infestation. Yogurt. We are daily using our diet in our diet. Yogurt is a natural probiotic, adds in the formation of good bacteria in our bodies. Remember, it has to be freshly made. If you have sore, regardless of the cause, yogurt might worsen it, but the better immunity, you need probiotic. So you can alternative to supplements in your body. Green tea. Green tea we are using daily in our morning tea for enhancing our immunity. As you know, green tea are very good source of vitamin C. It has antioxidant property as well as minimizing the cholesterol of your body. It improves your digestion. It also improves the immunity to your body for fighting COVID-19. We are very much familiar about green tea, but you know, several preparations are there in our Ayurveda and Indian traditional knowledge. Like green tea, 1,000 times more antioxidant property available in turmeric tea, which I know, you know, turmeric has having resource of curcumin. It will provide antioxidant property and provide protection against healthy skin, etc. First of all, we must know about turmeric. The golden spice, turmeric is known for its antioxidant and anti-inflammatory properties. Curcumin, the compound present in the turmeric, is a very potent agent and acts in healing of wounds and infection. This is the reason it is often suggested to have turmeric milk. Most people have it turmeric in the wrong way. If you are having haldi, don't have it in water. Instead, boil it in the milk and have popular turmeric milk. You can also take it with coconut oil and black pepper. Here I will show you the preparation of turmeric tea. Take a 2 cup of milk, 1 teaspoon of turmeric, 1 teaspoon of half teaspoon of cinnamon, a pinch of ground black pepper, tiny piece of fresh peeled ginger root, 1/4 tablespoon ginger powder, pinch of red pepper, optional. For sweetening, you can use raw jaggery, yeah, raw honey, or you can use without sugar. It will provide good immunity as well as having good antioxidant property. You can also prepare immunity booster powder from turmeric. This is the preparation. If you are, you can use 7 tablespoon of organic turmeric haldi, 4 tablespoon cumin seeds, 4 tablespoon coriander seeds, 7 tablespoon fennel seeds, 2 tablespoon dry ginger powder, 2 tablespoon whole black pepper, 1/2 tablespoon rolled cinnamon powder, 3 tablespoon cardamom powder, and the procedure of the preparations, these are the ingredients. First of all, keep turmeric powder and ginger powder in a separate bowl. And other ingredient, lightly roasted and on a slow flame, and get it. Nice aroma. Once it is roasted, then keep for cooling. After that, use grinder to grind them to a powder, add turmeric and dry ginger powder, and mix thoroughly. Store in a clean, airtight glass or steel jar. You can use that powder, a 1 spoon of premix, this immunity booster powder along with milk. You can use that immunity booster powder directly from the semi-boiled water. That will provide better immunity health. Some important natural antiviral foods are also reported by various agencies, various websites. I am also collecting these information from the various websites. Tulsi, star anise, garlic and ginger. These are potential natural antiviral foods listed and documented by various agencies. Ministry of Ayush also provide information regarding these foods are really antiviral foods. It will provide boosting your immunity, flushing out toxin. You can also take 3 or 4 pieces of star anise, give to boil it, and then add ginger and amla juice along with you can add garlic, and then you can take a sip of these herbs. It will provide helpful in immunity. Our Ministry of Health also provides general guidelines. If you are taking adequate water in a day, practice of yogasana, pranayama, meditation, as well as you incorporated haldi, jeera, dhaniya and lahsun in your cooking food, it will provide better immunity. As well as Ministry of Ayush also recommended that take chyawanprash 10 grams in a morning. Diabetics should can use sugar-free chyawanprash. Drink herbal tea, decoction, kadha made from tulsi, dalchini, kali mirch, smuti or munakka once or twice a day. For sweetening agent, you can use natural sugar or honey, or you can go with lemon juice. It will provide better health, immunity, as well as it helpful for minimizing your weight. If you are, you can go with golden milk with half teaspoon of haldi with 150 ml of hot milk. It will twice a day. It also provides immunity. Good food safety practices. If you are taking or purchasing foods from the market, what you should do first before using the foods which you have brought from the market, wash your hand for 20 minutes with soap after preparing and eating foods. Cover your mouth and nose with tissues or yourself when you are cough or sneezing. Remember, wash your hand after wash every fruit and vegetable before eating them. Disinfect surfaces and objects before and after use. Keep raw and cooked food separately to avoid harmful microbes infestation. Use different utensils or chopping boards for raw or cooked food to prevent cross contamination. Make sure cook and reheat food to adequate temperature, more than 72 degrees centigrade for 2 to 5 minutes. Some immunity booster kadas. I will show you the preparations, ingredient methods for prepare the immunity booster kada. Here, very simple ingredient recommended by Ministry of Ayush. Take a tulsi, 6 to 8 leaves. Take a black pepper seeds, 4 to 5 seeds. A small piece of ginger, 4 to 6 drop of lime juice or half lime, a cup of water, honey or black salt is optional. You can go with begin with a cup of water in a boil and bring it to boil. Then add all the ingredients in the boil except and allow them to boil. Let the mixture boil. It water reduces to half a cup. Once it is done, pour the kada in the cup. Add 4 to 6 drop of lime or lemon juice and add it in a bit of honey. Make it little sweet. You can take a sip 2 to 3 times in a day. It will helpful to is boosting your immunity. Some important ingredients which are showing in the plates. It is essential for our immunity. Some kadas are also prepared by Jharkhand people. Charanda Ban Kada. One listener is also with us, Mr. Prabhakar Singh, who will talk later. These kadas are helpful for improving white blood cells. It has a strong antioxidant property to provide protection against typhoid, dengue, viral fever, malaria, etc. Some kadas available in the market by the permission of Ministry of Ayush. Ayush Kada herbal tea, Aptoabhyas Kada powder is also available in the market. Boost immunity with Ayurveda, Patanjali, Deepa herbal pay, Chyawanprash, Muleti Kwath, etc. Dabur also having some very good kada, Anitas heart sip. It will provide cough and cold remedy as well as improve your immunity. Some references, you can go with these foods on the Swachh India, ndtv.com. You can also go with the Ministry of Ayush website. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing this valuable knowledge with us. Thank you very much, sir.